more going on there than maybe you and I generally are aware of. But what's fascinating, what seems to substantiate that viewpoint, that rather mystical viewpoint, is Revelation 21:1 in the new world, new heaven and new earth, one of the observations made is that there was no more sea. So speaking idiomatically, there's something negative consistently used about that idiom. In any case, these apostates are raging waves of the sea, foaming out their own shame. And the final example he uses is wandering stars. Now, the phrase here implies meteorites. That's the term that was they would use in those days because they're, you know, like wandering, you know, falling stars. What is a falling star? It's a meteorite. Its illumination is derived. It flashes brilliantly for a brief time, right? And if you'll excuse the Missler translation, that then makes an ash of itself. Okay. Sorry. Stars are in orbits ordained by their creator. Judges 5:20. These are not. These are wandering stars as opposed to stars in orbit. That's the concept. Okay. And it says they are destined for the blackness of the outer darkness forever. Matthew 8:12. I think this is very interesting because we're discovering black holes. Black holes. Certain stars have a certain gravity. If the gravity, if the characteristics are such that there's enough mass, that there's enough gravity, it'll collapse because the gravity of the star causes it to collapse. And if there's enough mass there, it collapses enough to become very, very dense. As the density increases, the gravitational forces increase, and the thing is, in a sense, circular. It finally gets to the point so that it gets so intensely gravitationally strong that even light can't leave. Anything that gets near it gets drawn into it. And so because of that, there's no radiation from these things. In fact, neutron stars, there's a whole area you can get into, and I don't want to get, we're short for time to get into all of this, and it's a little distracting. But the point is, the existence of a black hole is a very provocative idea in physics and astronomy and astrophysics because you can't see them, but you can detect them by the absence of stuff that's there and so on. They're finding ways to prove the existence of these things. But what's really intriguing about this is that the black holes have no light because light can't escape from them. Anything that comes near to them gets drawn into it. And incidentally, the mathematics of it is such that it's believed that within them time doesn't exist. They're timeless. That's a whole other issue. Some feel they're time tunnels, and there's all kinds of cosmic, you know, cosmological speculations about them. But it's very, very interesting to me. And you should be grateful. I saved you tonight with a whole diatribe on black holes, which have nothing to do with this anyway. But it's interesting here that Jude says that these are wandering stars, not in orbit, but loose, to whom is reserved the blackness of darkness forever. Isn't that interesting? These guys are destined for, at least spiritually speaking, black holes. That's kind of fun, I think. Now, a couple of things here. Just a couple of observations that are interesting with these five graphs. And I'm leading somewhere, trust me. Hidden rocks, unseen danger. Waterless clouds, false promise. Right? Autumnal trees, barren profession. Raging waves, wasted effort. Wandering stars, aimless course, ultimate perishing. It's interesting to me to see these five, for not only are they poetically articulate ways of expressing the spiritual truth, they're in a very specific order. It's not obvious from the rocks. You know, the interesting, nice, you read this, and say, gee, that's pretty articulate, kind of poetic language, and you move on. If you analyze it, the unseen danger, the false promise, the barren profession, wasted effort, aimless course, and destruction. It's, again, a process. This passage has been crafted masterfully. Now, these five graphical ideas, poetically articulated, present the same downward degeneration that verse 11 started with. That's why I've tied this all together. The men were present at the Christian love feast. They were carried away, fruitless, uprooted, dead, through shame. Outer darkness is their destiny. That's what those five things say. Let me give you a couple more contrasts, and we've made it. I want you to contrast these five things with our Lord. Hidden rocks threatening shipwreck with the rock of our salvation. Clouds without even a temporary blessing with he who comes with the clouds. The trees of death, this one's easy, tree of life. The restless, troubled sea, with he who leads beside still waters. The wandering stars in eternal darkness, with the bright and morning star. Interesting, isn't it? Whenever you do that, go one step further. Let's contrast these five with the believers in Christ, those who abide in Christ. These are dangerous rocks. We are living stones. 1 Peter 2:5. He speaks, these guys are waterless clouds. We are sources of living water. John 7. The dead trees versus the tree of righteousness. Isaiah 61:3. Raging waves versus, well, we have sing it all the time, right? Peace like a river. Let's use that. Isaiah 48:18. Wandering stars, in this case, look at Daniel 12:3, says that we, those who win many righteousness, shall, what? Shine as the stars forever. Those are stars in orbit. Those are not wandering stars, ultimately. Now, yes, there's points here, and you can dig those out for yourself. The point I'd like to leave you with is the craftsmanship that the Holy Spirit has woven into this text. Okay, so that's Jude 11, 12, and 13, and we've run our time. I'm going to leave you with a Bible trivia piece for next time. If you want, you know the answer, don't tell. Make your friends dig it out for themselves. We all know that Methuselah was the oldest man in the Bible, lived 969 years. Yet he died before his father. Isn't that a dandy? Think about that. We will deal next time with Methuselah. He's the oldest man in the Bible, yet he died before his father. And if you have a Bible friend, they get stumped on that. They'll immediately catch on when you recognize who was Methuselah's father. Enoch. He obviously did not die. But we're going to discover some things in Genesis. Next time, your lesson for next time is Genesis chapter 5. You're going to discover some amazing things out of the early chapters of Genesis next time. We're going to talk about Enoch. It's going to be fun. That's one reason I wanted to do it this way, because I want to leave time for Enoch, who is one of the earliest prophets. He has a fascinating ministry that takes some digging to get what's really going on there. The story of Methuselah and Enoch is really provocative. What's really interesting is a false book of Enoch quotes from Jude. Can cause a lot of confusion. There's several. In fact, there's three books of Enoch floating around the literature circuit that's apocryphal. There is a phrase a little different than the one in here, and many people think Jude took it from this ancient book of Enoch, except the ancient book of Enoch's a fraud. And I'll show you why it is from its own text next time. Don't waste your time in the Apocrypha unless you're just a scholar of ancient texts and you like to spend time in dusty libraries. But we'll deal with that next time. Enoch and Methuselah and that whole bit. I'm taking for granted that those of you in this room are not apostates. Or you wouldn't be here. You would find better ways to spend your Monday nights than to come here to, you know, these things aren't that interesting. So why are we spending our time on this? Because if you're saved, I don't believe you can get unsaved. I do think you have a commitment to abide in the Lord, and that's a whole other thing. We're talking about people here who've really rejected the truth, having known it and then rejected it later. That's what an apostate is. So why are we spending all this time? Yes, we get some insights in terms of our walk. I hope there's been some of that tonight. The way of Cain. We should have new insights, hopefully. The error of Balaam. And the rebellion of Korah. Those are meaningful ideas, even though we're not apostates. But the real thing we want to do is understand apostasy, because it is around us. It comes in attractive forms. It's easy to get confused. And furthermore, it's going to be the characteristic environment of the end. We talk about prophecy, we look at the Soviet Union, and we look at the peace euphoria that's in the air. It's all prophesied. We look at Israel and what's going on in that land. We look at Europe, what's going on there. All these things are consistent with our perceptions of biblical prophecy. But the stage that's going to really characterize the final chapter is a widespread, worldwide, global apostasy that will climax in the adulation of the man of sin. for lots of reasons, some of which we sort of just skipped over in the interest of time tonight, 2 Thessalonians 2, etc. For lots of reasons, I believe we can demonstrate the church will not be here.